Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC Edited Live Lecture. Dear friends, today we had a vivacious session on an essay on dramatic poesy, and we had learned a lot. Dear friends, we would like to tell you all that we would be continuing the lecture further on essay on dramatic poesy. And for this very discussion, we have once again with us in our studios Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya. Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya is a renowned academician. He is a renowned professor of English. He is a formerly Vice Chancellor of Kurukshetra University. He has authored numerous books. He has numerous students who follows him. He has students worldwide, both India and abroad. So let's welcome our guest, Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya, and let's try to know more and more on an essay on dramatic poesy. Hello, sir. Welcome to the Edited Lecture.
Thank you very much. Well, to resume the story of Dryden's essay on dramatic poesy. Those days, poetry was called poesy. Now we call it poetry. And even drama was considered poetry. We now call it poetic drama because there is the other drama also, prose drama, written in prose, not in poetry. So that's how things keep changing. And this point of change in literary compositions as well as critical appreciation of those compositions. Both keep changing. That is one of the points which this essay makes. Right from the beginning, there is a comparative talk about the moderns and the ancients. Moderns are 17th century writers in England, because Dryden belonged to the 17th century. So during his period, he himself plus his contemporaries, they were writing poetry and drama primarily. And drama also was considered poetry. At best, they will say dramatic poetry, but not poetic drama. Now it is reversed. Today we call it poetic drama. They used to call it dramatic poetry. Anyway, here Dryden makes a few points. Two are primary to it. One, that the essay is theoretical, defining things, what is poetry, what is drama, so on and so forth. Second thing that Dryden does in this essay is practical criticism. Practical criticism, when you make an appreciation of a literary piece, how good it is, how bad it is, you make an assessment and come out with its plus and minus both aspects, its virtues as well as its limitations. So that is what Dryden is doing in the case of the contemporary writers of his own time, comparing them with the ancient writers of the Greco-Roman period, which was 2000 years before Dryden's time. That was from 5th to 3rd century BC. That is the period of 200 years between which a lot of eminent literature in Greek and Latin came out, and Greek, in fact, even before that. Homer is said to be anywhere between 10th century BC and 8th century BC. So this is the plank, or rather planks, between which the essay moves. And Dryden makes it a dramatic discussion. He doesn't make it an essay actually, because essay has to be one man's opinion on a subject. That is an essay. You have essays by Bacon. Bacon was the first to have started this form of writing, essay. Short narrative, short prose discussion, that is what essay is. Later on, you have in the 20th century, Aldous Huxley, George Orwell, J.B. Priestley, so many. This was an age of essays. So here for the first time, John Dryden makes a beginning. He's a pioneer for that matter in the form of literary essay. And the essay of dramatic poesy is on the subject of drama. Drama in poetry. So dramatic poetry, he calls it. We call it poetic drama. So the first thing he does is he defines what a play is. Play, it is called drama. When it is staged, it is called a play, because different actors come, they play different roles, and the whole story of the play is enacted. So drama in acting becomes a play. That is the difference. Drama in writing is drama, but drama on the stage is a play. That's why you go to theater to watch a play. These days, of course, there is further progress. You go to see the movie, you see the play on the screen. So these are different presentations of the same thing. And Dryden goes on to do this. He gives finally a definition of a play also. What is a play? Because different people look at it differently. And here he gives us the definition of a play, that it is a presentation of life. Presentation of life which is both lifelike as well as which gives you pleasure. So pleasure and purpose, these are the two dimensions of dramatic poetry. In fact, these are the two dimensions of any piece of literature. It may be the shortest lyric. It may be the longest epic. It may be in between the narrative fiction. So all these forms will have the same qualities, which is to teach and to delight. So this is central to the essay by Dryden, that literature, it may be dramatic, it may be, those days narrative was not there, although epic is a form of narrative. So it may be epic or drama. It may be long poem or a short poem. The purpose of literature those days was considered to be twofold, to teach and to delight. And this is what Dryden emphasizes here also, to teach and to delight. Today, of course, we take a different view, because we do not consider literature to be didactic. In fact, we react and revolt against it. Why should we accept the imposition of someone else's ideas, his views? I am always reminded of a couplet in Urdu by Sahir Ludhianvi that represents the spirit of the age today. And that says, Le de ke apne paas fakt ek nazar to hai, kyun dekhein zindagi ko kisi ki nazar se hum. So that is the point. Dryden does not accept it. Dryden wants to impose his viewpoint on us, that you accept it as an instruction, as teaching. And not only his, he thinks literature under the name of literature, any piece of writing will serve both these functions. It will delight. It is a cheerful reading. At the same time, it will instruct. So that is one point that Dryden makes in this essay. Second is practical criticism. This is theoretical. In theory, he defines what a play is, what poetic drama is. It is written in verse. Yes, the other dimension to this definition is the debate about verse. Should it be rhymed? Should it be written in blank verse? The Elizabethans, where Shakespeare was writing, Ben Jonson was writing, Wycherley and others were writing. Shakespeare, the greatest dramatist accepted even today, he wrote his plays in blank verse. And he comes before John Dryden. Ben Jonson wrote in blank verse. He also comes in the 16th century, Elizabethan age. Of course, Ben Jonson wrote in rhyme also, because he was a classical minded. Shakespeare was not. Shakespeare, being untutored, had this advantage. He was not bound by any rules or regulations. Ben Jonson was, because Ben Jonson belonged to the school where the training in the ancients, training in the authorities of dramatic art, like Aristotle, and later Horace. Aristotle was a Greek in the 4th and 3rd century BC. And he was the first one to write on dramatic art. In fact, even other forms of writing, he is considered an authority. For example, there is a book by him called The Art of Rhetoric, great book. Although rhetoric was practiced not so much in his own age as later by the Romans. Because in the Roman Senate, there used to be regular debates. Caesar speaks, Brutus speaks against him. Then Antony speaks to support Caesar. So on and so forth. Then Cassius comes. So that was the platform where rhetoric was exercised, where rhetoric was, competed between and among different speakers. And whoever has the mastery over the art of rhetoric, he won the game. Not only game, serious game of politics, ruling the country. And the Greeks decided that, Romans decided that on the Senate platform. You know how Antony, could sway the entire crowd, entire Roman mob of Romans. After the death of Caesar, and he uses rhetoric in all its forms. He brings with him a piece of cloth and shows it to the people and asks them, do you recognize it? Don't you remember this belonged to Caesar? And where is Caesar? This piece of cloth is soaked in his blood, and that is where from I brought it. This sort of rhetoric he uses, and the public is moved, and moved to frenzy to the limit that they are out to have the blood of the murderers. Catch Brutus, catch others, catch Cassius, and let us kill them, drink their blood. It is this kind of thing rhetoric can do. So Dryden was trained in this sort of classical writing. Aristotle and Horace in particular, they were considered the masters of the art of rhetoric. And it is their books, Horace on poetry and Aristotle on drama. Both were considered authorities in their respective fields. So what Dryden is trying to say in his essay is that you follow the authorities, follow the masters, and he chides his contemporaries. He says, what you are writing, what you are producing in the name of poetry, in the name of drama, is all rubbish. You read the masters, follow the masters, try to imitate them. So this is the classical aesthetics. In classical aesthetics, there is no trust in the individual genius. See, later when Romanticism comes, in the later part of the 18th century and the early 19th century, this philosophy is reversed. They hate to learn the rules of the game because their belief is that producing or creating, they call it creation. Whereas with Dryden, it is a matter of learning, schooling, grinding. You have to be grounded in the basics given by the masters, and through rigorous training, through repeated practice of learning that rhetoric, practicing it, writing it, that will make you perfect. That's why idioms like repetition of things make you perfect. Try again. These slogans, these idioms, they come from the classical school of writing. In the Romantic school, they will hate to know the rules and much more to follow them. Because their belief is that a creative writer is born, is not produced, is not made, is God's gift. Either you have it or you don't have it. You can't acquire it. If you try to acquire it, it will be third-rate writing. So Dryden is chiding the third-rate writing, but he is not being romantic there. He is being very much a classic or classical advisor, teacher, instructor, writer, practicing himself also. And guiding his contemporaries that if you want to become a writer, learn from the masters. And the two acknowledged authorities who are called masters are Aristotle and Horace. Now, this is one point. Then the second thing that Dryden does is that he makes a comparative study of different sort of writings. So, simultaneously, along with his theorization about poetic drama, he is also the first critic, I would say, in English, who gives you practical criticism as well. Sidney came before him. Sidney wrote Apology for Poetry because there were attacks on poetry or literature in general. There was not much literature in other forms. It was only in the poetic form. The attack was by the Puritans, but they thought it will undercut the moral sense of the citizens. Citizens must have moral sense and a strong one. What is right and what is wrong? What is good and what is bad? That is why they were against literature as such. Only instructive literature should be there. So Dryden belongs to that school of the classics where literature is a matter of learning. And criticism is an imitation of the masters. So what he's trying to do is making a comparative study of the writers of the 17th century, his own age, and comparing them with the ancient writers. And for this purpose, he creates four characters. So he makes this essay a drama itself. Four characters representing four different positions vis-a-vis drama or dramatic art or poetic drama, any of these. And each one takes a stand, explains his position, and tries to score over the rival speakers, rival debaters. I mentioned all the four yesterday, beginning with Crites, C-R-I-T-E-S, Crites. Then Eugenius, second one. Third is Lycidius, and the fourth is Neander. Neander is said to be Dryden himself. After all, Dryden had to express his own views also amidst the debate. So that is what he does, that there are four viewpoints and One of those is the one which he prefers, which he adopts. Now, these four ones, let me spell out. Critias, the first one, he admires the ancients, Greco-Roman writers. He thinks they were the best, they were perfect, and hence they are the ideals to be followed. And contemporary writers, if they want to reach anywhere on the scale, they must follow these masters. That is the position that Critias takes. Second is Eugenius. Eugenius is for the contemporaries, for the modern writers. He says ancients or the ancient writers may be very good. I don't dispute that. I don't discard that. But that does not mean that any other writing coming after them is useless. He says, after all, every writer has some merit. And therefore, try to see the merit that contemporary writers have. You may remain an admirer of the ancients, but you must also acknowledge the merit of the contemporaries. So he makes a modification without rejecting the position that Critias took. Eugenius modifies that position by making place for the contemporaries also. He says, all right, we admire the ancients. They were perhaps the greatest, but that does not mean that there is no merit in the subsequent writers that have come in these 2000 years, including our own. And therefore, he says, it is not a question of nationalism. It is not a question that I am praising my countrymen just out of sentiment. It is not sentimental. I am being rational. And I am trying to show you whatever merit these writers also have. Okay, we are halfway. We will resume the story later. Yes, well, resuming the story of Dryden's essay of Dramatic Poesy, the point is that these four debaters, through them, Dryden wants to bring into focus the contemporary writing. because in his days it was an age of classicism. That is why they are called neoclassical writers, because they were followers of the classical writing of the ancient times. Dryden and after him Pope, they were the two greatest poets, and Dryden dramatist also of their times. And they followed the classics, so they are called neoclassics. Now these four debaters, as I said, hold four different positions. But finally, they do agree on a few things, one of which I mentioned earlier also, is their definition of the play. What is a play? And they accept that it is a representation of life. I am always reminded of Hamlet. You see, when Hamlet instructs the player how to present the scene on the stage, the last thing he says is, and the point that he rubs, and rubs very heavily, is that make a presentation as it were holding mirror up to nature. Your presentation must look natural, must look lifelike, must look as if we are watching real life and not stage presentation. That is the success of the dramatist and the actor also. So here Dryden is making the same point. And that is why time and again he uses the word nature. This word was very important during the neoclassical period. In fact, even earlier, the Renaissance. The point is that literature is nothing but a reflection of life. If it is just some individual fantasy, in the Romantic age later, individual fantasies will become literature. Your imaginary flights, good or bad, comic or tragic, so on and so forth. But here, that is not acceptable. That will be considered a freak. What is acceptable is which addresses common points of life, common to all. That is what they would call nature. So nature does not mean trees or plants or rivers and streams. No. Here nature means human nature. That unless you are presenting a true human nature, you are not a successful artist. The ancients did it. They continue to be great even today. That's why we read the epics, even our own epics, Ramayana, Mahabharata, and so on. Or the Greeks, Iliad and the Odyssey. Sorry. And similarly, the dramatists, we read Sophocles, he mentions these, the great dramatists of that time, ancient times, 4th, 3rd centuries BC. The three great dramatists in Greek were Sophocles, Aeschylus, and Euripides. Actually, Aeschylus comes last. First comes Sophocles, then Euripides, and then Aeschylus. They wrote great plays, which are translated now in all the languages known in Europe, at least. In English, they are taught in different universities and so on. So that is the point he is making, that follow nature. Later, these very things, these principles of construction, literary constructions, Pope will put in poetic form. Dryden is doing it in prose form. He writes an essay about it. Pope will write a poem about it. But the common thing in both is that they are being critics, not so much poets. In fact, that is the irony of the whole thing. That is the tragedy of the age. Dryden, Pope, and their contemporaries, they mistook criticism to be poetry. Well, the romantic poets and critics of the similar brand, they will not consider them as poets. They will consider them critics. Even in their poetry, even in their verses, even in their rhymed, narratives, they continue to be critics. Because it is the critical faculty which dominates their writings and not creative. So they can't be called creative writers in the romantic sense. But in their own aesthetics, they are creative. We call them critics, but from their side, they are being creative writers, poetic. So this is one of the things which Dryden argues through these four debaters. That's why it is called Essay of Dramatic Poesy, because he dramatizes the discussion. He dramatizes the debate, the issue of what is poetry, what is good poetry, what is drama, what is great drama, and what is not so great drama. And after these debates, as I told you, Critias stands for the ancients, Eugenius for the moderns, Lycidius for the French, Neander for the English. So the debate moves from one comparison to another. The first comparison is between the ancients and the moderns. Moderns, the contemporaries of Dryden, English writers, English dramatists, including Shakespeare, Ben Jonson, and so on, Wycherley. They are compared with Sophocles, Euripides, and Aeschylus. So this comparison involves practical criticism, because when you take up a play and you try to write its appreciation, where it is great, where it is not so great, where it is good, where it is not so good, that is practical criticism. But these days there is a new branch of criticism which can also be found here, and that is comparative literature studies. So where you compare two writers or two styles of writing, that becomes comparative study. So criticism has that form also. And it is the greatness of Dryden that he can combine all these. That's why he is the first source for several things. One thing, theorist of criticism. So you find a theory what criticism is. Secondly, you find the comparative study of different dramatists. Third, see, practical criticism. Appreciating individual pieces by different writers. just confine yourself to that individual piece alone. You are not making comparisons now. You are only going into its merit or demerit, how good it is and how good it is not, or how bad it is. All this Dryden is doing, and that's why he is considered a pioneer in theory of criticism as well as practical criticism. And third, I will say, which is not generally said, that he is also a pioneer of comparative criticism, of comparative literature. So all the three simultaneously he is doing in this single essay. That is one thing. The other thing that he is doing is, in the practical criticism, he makes a comparison between the ancients and the moderns. One comparison. The other comparison is between one class of moderns and the other class of moderns. Those two classes come from two different nations, the French and the English. Now, so far as the comparison between the ancients and the moderns is concerned, undoubtedly, most readers would also agree that the ancients are far greater than the moderns. But today, there is a whole school called the Shakespearean. Who would not accept this? Because Shakespeare, by majority of literature readers and critics today, is adjudged as the greatest dramatist of the world ever born. No wonder at his birthplace, I perhaps mentioned it earlier also, Stratford upon Avon. Avon is the river that flows through Stratford, and Stratford is on the banks of the river. It was a village, now it's a town, and it is all Shakespeare. You go there, everything is sold in the name of Shakespeare. Any token, any, you see, showpiece, any picture, and even pen or ink, all that in his name. And 10,000 visitors go to that place every day. This average was 10 years ago. Now it may be more. Anyway, so this is what Dryden is doing. But then, through this dramatization of the debate, very complex picture emerges, because no single group, neither individual nor group, comes out victorious, not even the ancients, because there are opinions expressed here also. Neander, for example. Neander says some of the aspects of drama are greater in our English drama than it was in the Greek or the Roman. And he mentioned Shakespeare among them, that Shakespeare is our greatest writer, dramatist, and he has qualities which you cannot find there in the Greek or the Roman. His characterization, for example, and his verse, his poetry. So both in characterization as well as in poetry, he emerges greater than any other writer, ancient or contemporary. So this is one point that is made here. Of course, Dryden, being a classicist, would not agree to it, although Neander does, even Eugenius does. Three of them do finally agree. Dryden concedes the ground that no doubt we have had, because Elizabethan age comes before the age of Dryden. We have had greatest of dramatists like Shakespeare and Ben Jonson. Ben Jonson, in fact, they will consider greater. That is the problem. Greater because they are classicists. And Ben Jonson was the one who followed the classical rules and wrote his plays strictly following those principles. And what are those principles? The chief is the principle of three unities: unity of action, unity of place, unity of time. What is the unity of action? That in every play, you have, say, 4, 5, 6 incidents. Each incident makes a scene. Sometimes the act. Generally, we have 5 acts in a play. In every act, there are different situations, different scenes. Now, whether they are logically coming out one from the other, or they are disparate, having no link between or among them. The point that Dryden is making, or any classical, and even the non-classical critics would make, is that action is a chain of incidents which are interrelated, interlinked, one emerging from the preceding one, and finally all put together making a whole. It is an organic whole. Imagine Aristotle giving this model 2000 years ago, today even more, 2000 in the age of Dryden, now 2300 or 400. So that is the unity of action, that all the incidents in the play are related to each other. Not that they are different one from the other, having nothing in common. Which means you will have to have common characters which are growing from one to the last. You will have to have incidents happening to them involving these very characters. Only then you can say there is unity of action, not otherwise. Similarly, unity of time, and before that, unity of place. Unity of place is that you are showing a play in 2.5 hours. This is the period that he mentions, that the time span of a play those days used to be 2.5 hours. He says in 2.5 hours, how much action can you show? Unity of time will be, the best is that you show the happenings of one day only, including love, marriage, finally separation or consummation. That will decide whether it is tragedy or comedy. If it is happy ending, it becomes a comedy. If it is unhappy ending, ending in death or disaster, then it is a tragedy. So, two forms of drama. But then it may be comedy, it may be tragedy. You have to have unity of action. Their contention is, and their objection is, to the contemporary English drama. He says, the English dramatists have come out with a monstrosity. Monstrosity is mixing tragedy with comedy, or mixing comedy with tragedy. He says it is neither tragedy nor comedy. And it becomes a windbag in which you put anything and everything. He says, this is not drama, this is absurd. There has to be some linking, you say, a line between one incident and another. And there has to be a progress from the first to the last. That's why Aristotle insists upon the beginning, middle, and end. And Dryden endorses, in fact swears by it, that the best plot is one which has a beginning, middle, and end. Beginning leading to the middle, and middle leading to the end. So logically connected from beginning to end. So you can't really drop any part, nor can you add any to this. It is this kind of perfection that Dryden is looking for there. As for time, unity of time, he says, has to be, because you are presenting in 2.5 hours, the maximum time presented can be 1 day, not more than one. If you include happenings of years, from birth to death, or from one generation to another, then it will ring false on the ears. How can the whole thing happen in 2.5 hours, all this? But I think Dryden, being a classicist, being literal-minded, as later Dr. Johnson will say, if you can imagine things happening in one time, you can imagine it happening in 100 years also. Why not? You go to the theater to see things imagined, things presented by imagination, not the real ones. So if you can imagine one, you can imagine the other also. So he challenges Dryden there. We will come to it later. But Dryden, being a classicist, cannot deviate from the rules. Rules is a sort of tyranny in classical writing. He is a neoclassicist, follower of the classical rules. Nothing is acceptable without the approval of the rules. So that is the unity of time, unity of action, unity of time, unity of place. Their point is that the action of the play, the different incidents in it, should not be happening at places far removed from each other. Say, one incident happening in Delhi, the other happening in Calcutta, or the third happening in Bombay. Where is the, how are they related? These days, of course, it is possible. Dryden would not have imagined the airplane. He would not have imagined bombs. He would not have imagined computer or mobile, that the same second there can be blasts at 10 different places. He would not have imagined that. But today we can. It happens. So this point he also makes. Neander, in fact, pleads this point. He says, life does not remain static. It was one form of life during the ancient times. But it is another form of life today in the 17th century. So you can't impose the rules derived from ancient life on to the modern life. He has a point. You cannot do that. Therefore, the rules have to be modified. And finally, they agree that to accommodate the subsequent literature, you have to modify the rules. And therefore, the definition of a play that finally emerges accommodates all the subsequent dramatic writing. Ancients are also accommodated. Medievalists are also accommodated. Elizabethans are also accommodated. And the neoclassical writers are also accommodated. So the essay finally concludes with this broad definition of play acceptable to all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much. We had a very, very productive session, and we tried to understand about an essay on dramatic poetry, the Dryden's criticism. Dear friends, we would like you to write to us if you have any kind of query, if you want to ask any kind of question, or if you want to give your feedback for this particular lecture also, then you can mail us at info.cec@nic.in. Your feedbacks are, yes, very, very important for us, and important for us is your viewing the lectures. We know that it is your curiosity and you want to know more and more. So keep watching us, as we would be uploading the lecture very soon on YouTube for you. We would be meeting again very soon and would be continuing the series further. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you once again.
Thank you.